Hey, it's producer Conrad. Hope you're having a great Thursday. Pete is on vacation this week, so I put together some of the best moments from Nite Lite. Tonight, Pete and I talk about why it's not a good idea to swim on National Swim a Lap Day and National Lightning Awareness Week. Then Pete and I talk about Hawk Tuah reality show. Pete talks with Matt Eisman about American Ninja Warrior and times in the past when they have worked together. Last but not least, Pete talks with Jimmy Pardo about comedies that they loved from the past. I hope you enjoy tonight's show.
We're rolling here tonight. How are you doing? Did you have a good weekend?
You know, I had a good weekend. Hung out with a friend that I haven't seen in a little bit in Appleton, so that was fun.
Nice. Did you hit the bars there or something?
We tried a new place out called Mr. Brew's Tap House in Appleton, and it was really good. Had a lot of beers on tap.
What if you're just making that up?
Why would I make that up?
What if you and this friend of yours have been robbing banks for like 8 years?
Oh, that reminds, I did watch Imaginary Friend. Maybe that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, if?
I did watch it, though.
How was it?
For like, I don't know if it's supposed to be a kid's movie or not.
Well, I think it is.
It draws the line because it gets very depressing at some points.
Really?
Yes. That's, and then the meaning behind it is,
I have not seen that yet. I saw Inside Out 2. We'll discuss that in just a minute, but I'm glad you had a good weekend. I'm glad you're not robbing banks. That's not, that's good. that's good. Need it now money, but it's not sustainable. I don't think not my experience, but based on what I've read or watched in TV and film. And none of them really kind of came out as phenomenal actors. And it depends who you include in the Brat Pack. Is Tom Cruise part of the Brat Pack? If he is, well, then he's your most successful guy. Is Kevin Bacon? Yes and no, people say. I think the jury is out on that. I think I would say my opinion has changed, but I think my most favorite is Emilio Estevez because he has a famous dad. There's a little nepotism there, but I thought he was a pretty good actor when he was young, and I think he kind of outgrew the whole Brat Pack thing. But I thought it was cool in watching Bratz, his interview, Andrew McCarthy's interview with Emilio Estevez. I looked at Emilio Estevez and I was like, he doesn't want to be doing this. I think he's being a pal. I think Andrew McCarthy has this unhealthy obsession. He turned into a documentary, not unhealthy, just kind of like an axe to grind a little bit. And I thought Emilio Estevez just seemed like a good guy. So he has catapulted himself to the top of my Brat Pack list. Or maybe Molly Ringwald, because she didn't want to do it. She's just like, let's let sleeping dogs lie. I don't need to do this. I don't need to go back. Those two might be in a tie for my favorite. My least favorite? Probably Judd Nelson. They say in the Brat Pack documentary that he kind of wanted to establish himself as the Marlon Brando of the group. I don't really see that. I don't even think he was that great of an actor. So he's probably my least favorite. Conrad, what do you know about the Brat Pack?
I know nothing, but I can tell you my favorite, not Brat Packer, but Packer.
Yeah, don't care. I hope you can tell me that. Well, let's do it. Who's your least favorite Packer?
I can't say. Yeah,
you can't say or you don't have one because
I don't have one. I just love all the Packers.
Too much of a homer. Oh my gosh. It's Minnie Kaling's birthday today, 45. She turns 45 and she is one of the most underrated Office ensemble members. She's also a writer and I think eventually became an executive producer of the show. Very talented writer, very talented actress. I would say pound for pound, and we might have talked about this, Mindy Kaling and maybe the guy who plays Toby, Paul Lieberstein, I think is his name. Their on-screen time, minutes per laugh, those two might be, or Creed. Those three might be my favorite. But Mindy Kaling, hilarious. She is hilarious on The Office. I haven't seen her in much else, although I think she was in, she was just in a kid's movie. I think she was in Inside Out 1, maybe. Anyway, that's my those are my thoughts on Mindy Kaling. You have a, we have an interesting day today, too. This is, we always track the national days of the year, folks. We like to share them. On this weird equinox, summer solstice, weird moon, sun aligning, it just happens to be National Swim a Lap Day and National Lightning Safety Awareness Day. That's crazy. The stars have aligned. These two are happening on the same day. And this is so bizarre because, you know, you're not supposed to be in a pool when it's storming out, right? When there's lightning. Conrad didn't know that. He was just being a, he was swimming a lap. He was trying to be a you know, a good citizen. He saw that it was National Swim a Lap Day and he went out swimming this morning. Luckily, I saw him. Maybe not in time, but I think the damn, we should probably just go to the clip because this is crazy. It's National Swim a Lap Day coinciding with National Lightning Safety Awareness Day, folks. And this is what happened this morning. We got it all on tape. Go ahead.
Conrad, what are you doing in the pool?
It's National Swim a Lap Day.
Yeah, but it's also National Lightning Awareness Day. Get out of there! Ah!
I mean, that it could have been much worse. Conrad?
Oh,
Conrad, you there?
Oh, yeah. I'm here.
You're a little off today. You okay, buddy? Did the lightning get you?
I think it clipped me a little bit.
Just a little bit, though. You're lucky. You're lucky to be alive. Conrad?
Yeah.
Okay. Just checking. You're kind of taking a powder in your mind because of the lightning.
It's foggy.
You just can't do that. Folks, I cannot stress this enough. It is National Swim a Lap Day. For those of you that adhere religiously to the National Days calendar, you got to read. You got to look at both, you know, what's going on. You can't be out swimming during a lightning storm, and Conrad is evidence of that. He'll be okay, though. Glad you're okay, buddy.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. I made an appointment at the doctor for you. He specializes in, you know, not so serious lightning strikes. So we'll see what happens.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. So just this. Did you get that? Conrad?
Memo? I'll write it down.
Folks, he was partially struck by lightning this morning. He's doing the best he can. We just got to get through the show. Conrad, I feel like I was swimming a relay with you or something when the lightning hit the pool.
You were kind of close.
I was trying to get you out of the pool. Yeah. I was trying to save you.
you should have just let me.
No. Who's going to produce the show? And I mean, you know, I care about you too. Hiya! No. That's just silly. The Bike Riders. You know, a good movie, fine for what it is. It's about a motorcycle club starting up in Chicago in the 1960s, and they end up becoming a full-blown biker gang. And it's Tom Hardy doing his best Marlon Brando. And what's the kid that played Elvis? Austin Butler. Austin Butler. And Jodie Comer. It was a good cast. Jodie Comer's great. And the guy from, I can never think of his name. I didn't even know who he was before Challengers, but he's in it too, like doing a documentary. It's okay. It's boring though. It's well done, but boring. And there are intense moments. And they talk about how, you know, the bikers of the 60s and 70s had class. And then these guys came back and it was about drugs and they had no morals. And it's like, well, you didn't really have morals before that, but they have worse morals. You know, it's kind of a 6 1/2 dozen, but kind of a cool look. Tom Hardy looked cool, gritty. Austin Butler kind of looked too clean cut for me. And Jodie Comer was really good. But Inside Out 2, folks, I cannot say enough good things about this movie. And if you have a 13-year-old or a 14-year-old or a kid dealing with all these crazy emotions that happen to kids at that age, you're going to love this movie. It's so sweet and so good. And I know now why it is crushing. They say it's going to overtake Barbie. It has the second highest, I think it has the highest second week box office take in the history of animated movies, the seventh overall second week take. So there's not much drop off. So, but I saw Inside Out on Friday night. My daughter and I watched it. And then we went to see Inside, because I hadn't seen it. And I wanted to see that one before I saw the second one. We went to see Inside Out 2 last night, and I was blown away. It was outstanding. And I'm going to say it maybe, I don't know where I'd put it right now. I'm still kind of digesting the film in my top 25 all time. I absolutely loved it. Better than Inside Out 1, which is lovely. But this film was so good. And the same character in the first one is now going through puberty. And all of her emotions, just like in the first one, are characters in her brain. And they're hilarious. But now they throw in puberty and anxiety. It was so funny and so sweet. I might put it above Toy Story. I don't know. Anyway, great film. Conrad's going to try to stay indoors, although it looks safe out there. You can never be too careful. I'm Pete Schwaba. This is Nite Lite. More next on the Civic Media Radio Network. Just like the sunny morning sent out a sheet he sends out sometimes with some fun tidbits and facts on it. From ranker.com, what cartoon character do you think would make the best president? We do have an election right around the corner, folks. Aunt Carla says, well, Aunt Carla is saying Boston Jim says President Wren and Vice President Stimpy. I can't endorse that because I never really watched Wren and Stimpy. They were huge for a while. People went nuts for Ren and Stimpy. They were kind of flash in the pan, though, I think. But that's a good one, Aunt Carla. I would not have, and Boston Jim. I would not have thought of that. Tom in New Berlin says, Felix the Cat. Nice. Retro. How about Sylvester the Cat? Just to hear his press conferences would be great. Everyone in the press corps would be trying to get him to say suffer and succotash, though. Tom from New Berlin says, was watching it yesterday, thought the same thing. It was creepy. Tom, you were watching Family Feud yesterday, like the old reruns? What are the odds of that? And yeah, it is creepy. And apparently towards the end of Richard Dawson's tenure as the host of Family Feud, he would throw a few back before the show. So we should all feel grateful, as should the women, that he stopped kissing. Because I think he was starting to slur his words and get a little carried away as the show went on. He would, like, mumble. I think it was my buddy Mike Toomey did a great joke. He was, survey says, like he got survey says, but you couldn't hear anything else. Anna from the 608 says, hi, Pete and Conrad. I would like to see Mr. Magoo as president. Well, who wouldn't, Anna? He looks distinguished anyway. That's a good one. Mr. Magoo. I could roll with Mr. Magoo as the commander in chief. And then Tom from New Berlin says, oh, clarifying. And I was in my teenage years and remember watching the show. I love the show because the questions aren't crazy like Jeopardy. Like sometimes I can watch Jeopardy and go, I'm pretty smart. Otherwise, other times I watch Jeopardy, I'm like, I'm a complete idiot. But Family Feud was not like that. It was sort of the everyman's game show. 100 people surveyed. Top answers on the board. That simple. Great concept. Wish I would have thought of it. But I was like two. So keep those texts coming, folks. You're welcome to comment, as you know, on anything we're talking about. I love the Family Feud comments. Also, who do you think, what cartoon do you think would make, cartoon character do you think would make a great president? Okay, so as promised, this is crazy, but every once in a while on Nite Lite, I get access to something just because of all my connections in the entertainment industry. And I don't have a ton, but I have a few and they're solid. We had my interview with Taylor Swift a couple months ago. Remember that one, Conrad?
Of course.
Yeah. What do you remember about that?
I remember that she was young.
Yeah, correct. And then we had the Travis Kelce sideline talk with Andy Reid. We obtained that. That was great. And tonight, this is very exciting. We have a sneak preview. As everyone has probably heard now, the Huck Tua girl is very popular. She made one gesture and said Huck Tua on that thing relating to how she takes care of her boyfriend. Yeah, it was a little risque, but it was barely English, so it feels okay to say on the radio. But now the world has gone bananas because a cute girl said something and everybody wants to watch it. And now the representatives and the influencers are getting a hold of her to make a reality show out of one thing she said at a rodeo or tractor pull or whatever it was. And she's going to do stand-up comedy. She's got merch coming out, apparently. But the reality show is the big thing because TMZ promoted this recently. They said there are rumors. Well, here at Nite Lite tonight, folks, it's a good thing you're here because we can confirm these are more than just rumors. They've already shot some episodes, and we've obtained an audio clip of a sneak preview of what this season, just to give you a taste of what the Huck Tua girls reality show will look like. Conrad, let's roll it.
This week on Huck Tua the Top.
What's the matter, bro? Everything okay with Haley?
I'm wondering if there's someone else. I mean, she told me she'd never Huck Tua on another thing, and that mine was the best.
Bruh, they always say that. But now she's famous, I might want to date famous guys. With famous things.
Chad wants to put a ring on it, but Haley reminds him who calls the shots.
Where have you been?
I was hanging with the Kardashians. What's your problem?
You know I don't like them skanks.
Will you chill? We were just making a sex tape. God.
You've changed. I mean, you never Huck Tua on my thing anymore. Then you want me to sign a prenup after I made all that Huck Tua merch.
You think screen printing merch makes you special? I'm the brains behind Huck Tua. Can you even begin to comprehend how much pressure is on me? How hard it is to get an entire season of television out of a foreplay technique?
Whatever. You ain't Huck Tua on my thing in weeks. And last time you did it, you barely even Tua it.
And things get complicated when Haley meets a new love.
You're dating Tua Tagalovian? You're giving the Huck Tua to Tua?
Oh my God, grow up.
Don't miss the next episode of Huck Tua the Top, when the Huck Tua girl and Tua get Tugavalovian.
Huck Tua.
That's one to see.
It's on my list.
I'm not a reality show guy. And great that Todd Michaels got another gig.
Right.
But that sounds like a good show. I don't know. It sounds insightful. There's some drama. She just seems like a girl trying to make it in this world. And poor Chad, you know, what's he supposed to do? He's dating this girl. She becomes famous. Now she's hanging with the Kardashians and dating NFL quarterbacks like how do you say his last name?
Tagovailoa.
I don't think Chad said it right.
Tagovailoa.
Tagovailoa. So, you know, that's how fame does change people, folks. And Haley Welch is her real name. She's no different. So God bless her. I hope things go well for her. It sounds like a good show. Maybe we'll play it again in the second hour just to see what people think. I don't know, but you're welcome to weigh in on the the Hawk Tua girls reality show. I think it's, what was it called? Hawk Tua the Top?
Hawk Tua the Top.
She's going to hawk her way, Hawk Tua her way to the top. So good stuff. And a tip of my hat to the Nite Lite journalists that got their hands on that that piece of tape, because that's invaluable. People won't see that until it comes out on, but we gave them a sneak peek here on Nite Lite tonight. Tom says, I'm sorry, that's not Tom. That's an old text I was about to read. Tom says, what does the term mean? And then he quickly says, sorry, got it. He figured out. Tom says, what's wrong with lotions? Well, Tom, listen, I'm no expert, but I think that would indicate, you know, you don't have a girlfriend or you're a stag, you know, you're going solo. This guy's dating Haley. She's got, he's bringing other stuff to the party. It's too late to turn back now. I believe I'm falling in love. It's too late to turn back now. I believe I'm falling in love. I found myself phoning her at least 10 times a day. So unusual for me to carry on this way. I tell ya, I can't sleep at night. I'm trying so hard to convince myself that this feeling just came.
Broadcasting live from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. Whatever gets you through the night, it's all right, it's all right. And now, a guy who travels so he can pretend he's on the lam, Pete Schwaba.
Todd Michaels, who will be joining us momentarily, says Spotted Cow is his summer drink. That's a really popular one. Mac on the stream says Jack and Coke, another big one here in Wisconsin. You ever have Jack and Coke, Conrad?
I'm not a fan of whiskey at all.
Oh. All right. I guess we can still be friends. But Sarah Jean says coffee, iced coffee, Lotus drinks. I don't even know what a Lotus drink is. We need to Google that. Sandy Jean says, what's a spotted cow? I think that was some type of dig because she seems to be friends with Todd. I'm just managing this conversation now. Vicky says, Wisconsin famous beer. Sandy Jean, thank you. Vicky, Sandy Jean, Todd's favorite. Amanda says, ha, the ghost background. Nice, Con. If you're watching on the stream, we're getting set because Todd Michaels is about to join us, and we're pretty excited about it. And he is going to join us, not as the producer of the Mino and the Mayor show here on WGBW in the morning and on WISS, but he's joining us for his side hustle. And that's Paranormal Investigator. And he does a great job talking about it. And I love talking about it to him. So we had to have him back on the show. He has become a Nite Lite frequent flyer and joins us now. Todd, how are you? Showing off the spotted cow to all his fans on the stream.
Let me just do this right now.
Can we do that?
I can have a beer.
You're the station
because
manager.
I'm not in control. Yeah.
Okay.
Because I'm the station manager.
You're setting a fine example right now.
It's so funny because I talk a lot about spotted cow and people know I like it. People think that I drink a lot of it and I don't. I only have a couple here and there.
Okay.
But to be nice to me, when I do something nice for people, the first thing they do is buy me Spotted Cow. And I think, in fact, Khan actually bought me some Spotted Cow a while ago to say thank you for something that I helped him with. And so now I have an entire fridge just outside my studio here at home filled with Spotted Cow. So if I have one of those, if every once in a while, I just pop one open and enjoy.
Conrad, just curious, but have you ever bought me any kind of libation or beverage? Apparently,
you don't drink. I can't get you anything.
What do you got against a lemonade or a nice champagne coolie?
There's some Diet Coke out there, you know.
Todd, great to have you with us. Thanks for being here, buddy.
Thanks for asking me to be on.
There are a few guests that light up the stream when they're on the show, and you are definitely one of them. So you've got your fans. I don't know if they're fans of you as a producer or as a paranormal investigator, but either way, you're a great guy, and I'm not surprised. So welcome back to Nite Lite. Let's talk about this. First of all, tell us what's going on Mino and the Mayor. What can we look forward to? Those guys have so much fun in the morning, and you're such a huge part of that.
Well, I have to tell this story because this happened last week. Mino and the Mayor had an anniversary show on Wednesday of last week. It was their anniversary. Let me put it that way.
Yeah. Hosting, not their anniversary.
Of hosting the show. Okay. Yeah.
Because they're friends. Well, I mean, but let's not.
Listen, sometimes they act like they're a married couple. So we had a show, and Jim, who is the former mayor of Green Bay, always has great ideas. He is a big thinker. Like, he's a big picture kind of guy.
Yeah.
Okay. And so he wanted to do something big. He wanted to hire a helicopter to fly over and drop ping pong balls. He wanted to shut down the street. He wanted bands. He wanted food trucks, the whole thing. Right. Well, as you know, Pete, from working with us in Green Bay, we have like two people that work at the station, like me and Amanda, and then Khan's there and you're there. And so when I realized things were kind of getting out of control, I said, Jim, enough with the ideas. We love you, but we're never going to be able to pull all this off. So let's just have a regular show that day. We'll do something where maybe we'll have like a lunch with Mino and the Mayor out in the public or something like that down the line. Well, last Wednesday, I pull up to the station, and all the parking spots around the station are bagged off. I said to myself when I drove in at literally 5 o'clock in the morning, Jim forgot to cancel the party, because he literally reached out to the city of Green Bay and had this all planned out. So we couldn't even park to come into work because Jim had all the meters bagged off. And then literally about 6:15, we're on the air live. And as we're on the air, the window you can see out of and the window that Khan can see out of, a big flatbed truck pulled up with barriers and barrels and cones and a flashing sign. They were going to close off the streets for the anniversary show that wasn't. So, you know, Mino's like, oh no. And I'm like, Jim, you've got to go out there and tell them not to close down the street, because they were going to start doing it. And he literally had to go out and tell the folks, I'm sorry, I made a mistake. I didn't cancel it. I, you know, went overboard, whatever. But they were about to close down a street for an anniversary celebration that wasn't going to happen. So that's that, you know, Khan, you've got a great job because you work with somebody like Pete. I love working with Jim and John, but that's why I have a refrigerator filled with Spotted Cow at home. Okay.
That story started off very reminiscent of turkeys being dropped from helicopters.
Honest to God, that conversation came up on the show that morning.
Oh, that's fun. So did they just do it because he used to be mayor? Did they listen to
him? Pretty much. He just started contacting people and saying this and that. And I had bands calling me up and saying, what time are we showing up? And I'm like, no, everything's, you know, nothing's going to happen. Please don't show up with your cheese curds or your food truck.
I would be so sad if that happened, because I wouldn't get to hear the very loud motorcycles and mufflerless cars driving by, people with a point to prove.
I don't know if you can see in the chat there, but I think Amanda actually popped a picture in of Jim out telling the people, please don't set up those cones. Oh, do you see all that equipment on that flatbed?
I would love to see that. I don't see it though.
Okay. It's in the Nite Lite show text page. So,
all right. Very good. And someone said, Amanda's making, she says they're all here for your beard, Todd. They're fans of the beard.
Well, the beer or the beard.
Either one. That's going to put the butts in the seats. All right. So this is kind of cool. This, I thought of you immediately, Todd, when I heard of this. It was just a friend of mine posted this on Facebook, a 72-second signal from outer space that the government still can't explain. And people, they've had theories about it. Some were discounted. This happened in 1977 and was tracked by the Ohio State University Big Ear Radio Telescope. They gave it, a guy put all these coordinates on a piece of paper and just wrote wow next to it. So it became known as the wow signal. And it appeared to come from the direction of the constellation Sagittarius. What do you make of this?
As with, and I would consider this somewhat paranormal just because as what we know in life, it's not normal, right?
Right.
It's other than normal. So I kind of throw it into that category. It's one of those things where you can sit back as a resident of this planet and automatically blow it off and say, well, it's nothing. People are making a big deal out of nothing.
Right.
And yet there's, if you go online and you look up the WOW signal, tons of information. Ohio State University is involved with the investigation. That's where they found it. As you said, they've not been able to say this is what this is. And so if you look at that, if you look at the information that you can easily find online, and there's videos and documentaries about it that you can, you know, short ones that you can kind of watch and stuff like that. If you look at this and go, okay, this is not normal, or somebody's messing with us, if that's your vision of it, I think you're just very short-sighted.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, stuff like this actually does happen. You can talk about Roswell and what people thought happened there. One of the big ones, and I think you and I were kind of talking about, maybe mentioning tonight, were the lights in Michigan, in Western Michigan, back in 1994, which has continued to confound scientists and law enforcement, and even the people who, and not just like a person who said, hey, I saw some lights in the sky.
Right.
We're talking about like a whole community that saw that. This kind of stuff happens. Sometimes we find out about it. Sometimes we don't. I knew a little bit about this WOW signal, but I didn't hear about it until like the last 2 years of my life, when I really started investigating other things other than ghosts, looking into Sasquatch and aliens and cryptids and all that kind of stuff. I didn't know about it till then. So you almost have to go out of your way to find this stuff, but it's out there.
Yeah. I thought this was interesting. It said, the signal itself appeared to be an unmodulated continuous wave, although any modulation with a period of less than 10 seconds or longer than 72 seconds would not have been detectable.
Right. So that's a big amount of time.
But 72, it's like they stopped it, or that's when they stopped detecting it, like it kept going, or did whoever sent the signal stop? That's what I'm wondering, I guess.
Basically, it could have been a longer signal, but anything more than 72 seconds would not have been picked up by their equipment at that time, is my understanding of what that means.
Scientists or physicists have detected a certain frequency that other worlds could communicate with us on. If that is from some other world and they did it once, here's why I think it's some kind of weird coincidence, because it hasn't happened again that we know of. It seems like if they made contact and they know it, that it would happen again, right?
Would it?
Listen, if I'm the alien, I'm making this a regular thing. It's like the Wednesday night beam down to Earth Club.
Well, you have to also take contact. You have to take into consideration time and space and all that kind of stuff. You know, they say that the sun could go dark and we wouldn't know for several minutes before we would know, because of the travel in space and all that kind of stuff. I don't know, and I have not read up enough on this particular thing to know how long ago that signal would have had to have been created in order for us to finally see it or hear it on August 15th, 1977. It could have happened many years before that, and we were just actually accepting the signal on that day or receiving it.
My guest is Todd Michaels. He's the producer of Mino and the Mayor here on WGBW and WISS, and he's a paranormal investigator in his free time, and he joins us tonight to talk about the WOW signal. This signal happened in 1977. It was a 72-second, or the signal lasted for 72 seconds, and scientists still don't know what it is. That's kind of strange. Like, What do you think, Todd, based on what you've read, what is the most likely reasoning for this? Or you could just take a stab at it if you want.
I just think it's more than just something naturally occurring. You hear a name like Carl Sagan, because Carl was involved with investigating this, and some of the reports were written for Carl Sagan. If you don't know who Carl Sagan is, very well known individual who talked about space and time and all that kind of stuff. For him to get involved and to be interested in this, I think says a lot. within the last couple of years, I don't know if we've had this discussion before or not, but all the discussion about the weather balloons, is it a UFO? Remember just a couple of years ago during COVID and all that kind of stuff, all this weird stuff was happening. And all of a sudden it went away. And I think what happens is we get to a point where we're not able to take the next step in learning on some of this stuff. So we give up on trying to find out more. I think there's a group of people that continue to study this type of thing. I truly think that it could be some sort of communication from another place in the universe, if you will. Yeah, I really do.
What about that incident a few years ago where all the balloon animals were floating in the sky? And they traced
Where did this happen?
Some kids,
what kind of spotted cow were you on?
Some kids party in the suburbs. This is interesting, though. I thought this in 2017, Antonio Perez, assistant professor of astronomy and astrophysics at a college in Florida, proposed that the hydrogen clouds surrounding two comets could have caused it. The hypothesis was dismissed by astronomers, including members of the original Big Ear research team. So they did discount it, and I find that interesting. So maybe we can put some closure on this coming up next, because I have other things, including the Michigan incident, I want to ask you about. Todd Michaels is my guest. This is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Forget a small moonbeam.
You can't beat the memories you gave me.
Fold in lightly with a dream.
Nicholas on the stream says Todd is the man. Amanda likes the beard line. Sandy Jean says that signal could have been from hundreds or thousands of years ago. Yeah, that's true. I mean, that's interesting. Amanda also says, remember the government has declared aliens exist a while back. Did they make an official declaration, Todd?
Wasn't there something with even Obama and stuff like that? There was going to be some big announcement about aliens and aircraft from outer space and all that kind of stuff. I think, again, we're at the point where we're not equipped right now to have all the answers. And because of that, there's so much speculation and there's misunderstanding and people who don't want to believe. And as I've told you before, I'm a skeptic on everything, right? Yeah. Could this be those two gases from those whatever? It could be. I don't know. But it's still very, very interesting in the fact that half of the scientist, or the science community feels one way and another half feels the other way means there's more questions to be asked. And, you know, are we ever going to be prepared for these real answers? By the way, I have to tell you, when I'm on your show, the time goes so fast.
Yeah, I agree.
When I'm sitting in the studio producing Mino and the Mayor, I literally have to try and stay awake because it goes so slowly. But when I'm on your show, it's like we had to go into a break already. It's
I hope they're listening and I hope they heard that.
They're not. They're in bed sleeping.
Listen, Mino comes by. He just stops by sometimes like this is his man cave and just comes in here and sits down. I love it. So that has been discounted. Amanda also on the text line says you both need to go to Sputnik Fest in Manitowoc or the Green Bay UFO Festival. I've never
the UFO Festival is coming up actually in the next couple of weeks. So that would be, we should go there and do like an on location, on the street kind of thing.
I love it. We have a caller, Todd. Can you take a call with me?
Sure.
It is Cindy from Appleton.
Fantastic. Cindy called last night too. How you doing, Cindy?
Good. How are you?
Doing great. How are you tonight? What's on your mind?
Well, I don't know how you could be skeptical of there being aliens because, I mean, there's just billions, and not millions, billions of other universes out there. There's got to be other universes that have, you know, livable, habitable planets with people or whatever they might be. There's got to be other ones of them out there. And I still believe that aliens have probably come to the Earth and said, this is one of the most ignorant species I've ever seen because they're destroying their own home.
Right.
I decided to go somewhere and waste their time with a species that isn't so ignorant.
It's interesting you say that because I hear all this stuff about going to Mars and we're going to colonize Mars while we let this planet, we already have paradise here if we treat it properly. And you're right, Cindy, I don't understand why people do that. And certainly, and I'm sure you'd agree, Todd, out of all the, out in the stratosphere or the different galaxies, there's got to be life, whether it's like ours or not, I would think.
Well, our species really only cares about us. Okay. Right. We care about how it affects us directly. And if it doesn't affect us directly, we don't care about it. So whether that's conservation on Earth, whether that's helping your fellow man, and that just goes into, thinking about outer space, thinking about ghosts. I mean, if it's not right there in front of us and affecting us this moment, it doesn't exist in our lives.
Do you want there to be aliens, Todd? How do you feel about that?
Well, listen, I mean, nobody wants to wake up with aliens like sucking the life blood out of your brain or something like that, right? Because that's what we grew up with when we were watching movies, right?
Yeah.
So nobody wants that. But again, I think it'd be interesting to know more about what's really out there, as I feel the same way about paranormal stuff and energies and spirits and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I believe there's probably something there. What it is, I don't have those answers.
There you go, Cindy. Thanks for contributing. Have a great night.
You're welcome. You too.
All right. Cindy's always fun. So Todd, let's talk about the Michigan incident.
All these
crazy lights. I remember I was coming home from a stand-up gig, I think in Grand Rapids, with my buddy Jimmy Pardo, and we heard the report. What I find interesting about this is that that link I sent you, the government did declassify what it was, but I don't think they know. That scares me. I understand a signal that comes from billions of whatever away, but when you have objects flying around, you think we're so protected and that there's the Air Force and all these, you know, whatever. That one threw me.
Well, again, I think that if we live our lives thinking, let's just talk about being American. If we only worry about what's going on in our country, again, closed-minded thought process. So you are saying that you were in Grand Rapids, Michigan around the time that this took place?
Yeah, I believe so. I think that was the night we were driving back. It was very late. We left after the second show. It was like 11 o'clock at night, maybe. And I don't remember when this happened. I did watch a special on this. It might have been on Discovery or whatever, but I'd have to piece the timeline together. But I think we heard it on the radio or something, or we were.
So I think it was 1994, if I'm thinking about the same one as you. Netflix brought back Unsolved Mysteries a couple of years ago, and they did a great episode on this particular thing. And the thing that blew me away by this, again, as I mentioned at the beginning of our segment, it wasn't just one guy out in a field, you know, with a spotted cow in one hand and a farm animal in the other hand. This was, these were communities of people that said, oh my gosh, right?
Yeah.
These were law enforcement officials on the ground who experienced it. This was our government coming in and investigating this. And I think, again, I'm not a conspiracy theory kind of guy. I'm just not. I'm sure there is some stuff going on. Sometimes I don't want to know about it.
Right.
But if the government says, oh, it's nothing, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's nothing. It just means they don't want to have to either tell us what's going on, or they don't quite know and they're not ready to make that assessment. I swear, if you have Netflix, look up Unsolved Mysteries. It's the new version of it without Robert Stack, which is a shame, but he is dead. We can't bring his ghost back to host the show, which is a shame too. Yeah, right. But I mean, it's a great episode and it really digs into what actually happened on that night.
That's really interesting. And there are pictures on that news broadcast I thought were interesting. They were objects. And the government declassified it and said they didn't know what it was. And that's weird, too, because it's like, why would they if they didn't know what it was? I don't know. It's strange. David Williams says on the stream, Todd Michaels Daring knows the deal. Him and I have seen and experienced a lot together.
I've got stories there.
Our award-winning news team here at Civic Media gets the job done and keeps you informed. This is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba on the Civic Media Radio Network.